gastrointestinal lower gastrointestinal bleeding. This is hematochezia or melena. Hematochezia is the bright red blood going through the lower gastrointestinal tract, and melena is the brown blood. This is because the blood already has been digested. This lower gastrointestinal bleeding doesn't mean that the cause is on the lower gastrointestinal tract. It can be on the upper gastrointestinal tract. For example, hematochezia could be due to a, let's say, rupture of esophageal varices, if the blood is also going through the gastrointestinal tract very quickly, or melena if that blood has been digested. But the most common causes of lower gastrointestinal bleeding are the diseases that affect the lower gastrointestinal tract. This includes most commonly diverticular disease, diverticular bleeding, angiodysplasia, arteriovenous malformations, inflammatory bowel disease, hemorrhoids, anal fissures, etc. Remember that the most common gastrointestinal bleeding or lower gastrointestinal bleeding are diverticular disease in the elderly patient. Then the diagnosis could be with colonoscopy only if the patient is stable. In angiography, if the patient is unstable, and the sigmoidoscopy, or here we are doing the arteriography or the anoscopy and sigmoidoscopy could be if the patient has a lot of bleeding, it is stable, because if it is unstable, we do the arteriography. If it is a stable colonoscopy, so between we can do this anoscopy. Now, if the patient has less than 0.5 milliliters per minute of blood loss, most of the time the bleeding will stop spontaneously. And because it's spontaneously, then we can do the colonoscopy after the bleeding stops. If the rate at which the blood is leaking is between 0.5 and 2 milliliters per minute, then we can do something called the tagged red cells. This is, we will put, or we will take out red blood cells of the patient, we will inject technetium, and then re-put them in the patient's blood, and we will see where it is leaking. This, it takes a lot of time to be done, so when we do this, most of the time the bleeding has already stopped. But we do this because in case the patient re-bleeds, we now would know what's the place or localization of that bleeding. And the arteriography, then it is when we have more than 2 milliliters per minute of blood loss. Sometimes the tagged red blood cells is done independently of the rate of the bleeding, and the arteriography, remember, it is for a lot of blood loss and patients that are unstable. And we don't do the enema or some study that needs contrast, because if we need to do the arteriography, it is going to be very difficult to distinguish the contrast and the blood, so we cannot do that. The acute management is first to stabilize the patient. So we will give IV fluids with two IV bore lines. If the patient has hemoglobin less than 7 milligrams per deciliter, then we will give a pack of red blood cells. If there is also thrombocytopenia, we replace that. If the PT or the international ratio, we have these abnormalities, then we can give fresh frozen plasma or prothrombin complex concentrate, and vitamin K, not for the acute event, but later. That we will give it in the acute event, but it's not going to work for the acute event, the vitamin K. If the patient is on Coumadin, then we give, or in heparin, we give protamine sulfate. Anyway, this is the acute management, and the long-term management depends on the etiology. If it is, for example, diverticular bleeding or angiodysplasia, surgery. If it is, for example, the upper gastrointestinal bleeding, then we could do a clip placement or some catheter embolization or just the epinephrine injection, for example, in malaria waste tears or something like that. But remember that even though we have a lower gastrointestinal bleeding, because we don't know if it is coming from the lower gastrointestinal tract or from the upper gastrointestinal tract, we always need to put the nasogastric tube first. And this is going to tell us if it is a upper or lower gastrointestinal bleeding. And after this, we can further proceed with the lower gastrointestinal bleeding or the upper gastrointestinal bleeding that we saw on the previous video. So, and now that we know that it's the lower gastrointestinal bleeding, the question is, where is the localization? Because we want to know if we need to do a right or left hemicolectomy. So, in order to answer that question, we do the tagged red blood cells scan, or this study. So for that, many times it is done, even though the rates of blood loss could be different. So in lower gastrointestinal bleeding, the question is, where is the localization? Sometimes if we don't know the localization, if it is right or left, we do the total colectomy. And we need to also be conscious about the occult blood loss, that this is occult, and so we are not, sometimes we would not see it. But the management could be quite similar